Welcome to Digital Nation, your chance to see the UK through the eyes of our local TV channels. In this week's show, we visit a superb city farm in Wales, sheltering some of Swansea's select breeds. In England, we visit Bristolian Ben, the mega marathon man as he crosses his final finishing line. And we take a trip to Scotland to rustle up a hearty hedgerow smoothie in Glasgow. You can comment on all of our clips using the hashtag DigitalNation. First to Edinburgh and the Scottish National Portrait Gallery, where their exhibition, Facing the World, is a collection of famous faces. The exhibition features self-portraits from celebrated artists such as Rembrandt and Warhol. Plus, you can even get in on the action yourself. So smile for the camera.
Here at the Portrait Gallery, we have an exhibition called Facing the World, Self-Portraits from Rembrandt to Ai Weiwei. In front of one of the stars of the exhibition, self-portrait by Rembrandt. At the time this portrait was painted, he was declared bankrupt. He had to sell all his property at auction. You can see his furrowed brow. You can see the tired eyes. But there is still a little bit of sort of mild contentment that he's displayed on his face. So maybe he was looking to say to people, the worst is over, I've been declared bankrupt, it's happened. The Scottish artist, John Byrne, said, I can't think of a quicker way of getting to the heart of the matter than painting a self-portrait. This was painted after John Byrne came back from America in the late 60s, and I suppose you could say it sort of depicts him as a hippie, or definitely in the hippie era. Warhol made many self-portraits throughout his life, again following the tradition of Rembrandt, and he used them to explore role play rather than to present a version of himself to the world. Here we are in the photo booth, which is also part of the exhibition Facing the World. And when you come to the exhibition, you can come and take your photograph in the booth as many times as you like, and your photograph will immediately be broadcast in the exhibition on screens. And I challenge you to fit as many people as you can into the photo booth. And I think the record at the moment is about 5, so there's lots to play for.
We canter to Cambridge now to catch a Paralympian's Rio return that's thrown up a surprise even he wasn't expecting. Louis Rolfe revisited his old college after bagging a gold and a bronze in cycling. But to his delight, his name is now printed on something much, much bigger.
A hero's welcome for the Cambridge College student turned double Paralympic medalist. Returning to Cambridge Regional College from Rio with a gold and bronze medal, Louis Rolfe was surprised to find the college sports hall renamed in his honour.
I'm completely overwhelmed. I knew that the welcome back was going to be something special, but I didn't realise that the college had actually named the sports centre in my honour, so I'm really happy and really privileged to be a part of this college.
Louis was inspired to take up paracycling after watching the event at the London Paralympics in 2012. 4 years later, and he's won 2 Paralympic medals in Rio, a gold medal in the team sprint alongside Jodie Cundy and John Allen Butterworth, as well as a bronze medal in the individual pursuit.
I hope that it will inspire people to think that with hard work and determination, anything is possible, because I haven't come from a sporting background, so I've just been inspired by what I've seen in London, and hard work and determination has got me where I am today.
Alongside training, Louis's also been studying for an extended diploma in sports studies at the college. Now returning for his second year, the college believe Louis will become a role model for other students.
Just an amazing feat, and the work that he's put in to get where he is. You know, he started on a level one course here at the college. He's progressed all the way through. He's continued his training, and he's got better and better as the years have gone on. And for him to achieve what he's achieved is unbelievable.
For Louis, it's back to college and training, where he'll decide his next sporting goal. Meanwhile, his signed picture will hang in the renamed sports centre as a reminder of his Paralympic triumph.
For people who have hearing impairment, public places such as restaurants and cafes can be especially difficult. In East Brighton, one establishment has set up not only to welcome deaf customers, but also employ staff who don't have hearing to create a hub for their local community. Latest TV popped along for a coffee.
The UK's first ever deaf cafe has opened up in East Brighton Park, and I went along to find out more.
The thing that's different about this cafe is that most of the staff are deaf. So I know some people have been calling it a deaf cafe or, you know, a place that deaf people can go to get help. Now, obviously, if anyone turned up and asked for help, we'd do our best to help. It's a community cafe. But it's really a hub for deaf people to come together to help the community.
So this is our main room of Dotties. We had a party here on Saturday night, so we've still got the balloons up. Here's Jonathan serving behind the counter. How's it going today, Jonathan? Is it good?
Yeah, it's been going really well. We've been serving lots of coffees.
We're doing teas, coffees, sandwiches, just so that our crew in training can get a bit of practice in.
And what were you doing just before you started work here? You got married quite recently, didn't you?
Yes, I did. I think it was about 3 months ago, roughly.
And who's your husband?
Jonathan Hachibi, who's working out in the main front of house section.
I just couldn't leave without trying out one of Jonathan Hajibi's coffees, so I headed out to front of house to try them for myself.
Could you run a marathon? How about a few hundred in as many days? Last year, Digital Nation met Ben Smith in his home city of Bristol, raising money and awareness for charities as he embarked on a mammoth mission of 401 marathons in 401 days. So let's catch up with Ben on his penultimate run of the tour.
Meet Ben Smith, the real-life marathon man who's run miles every day for the last 400 days.
It's been an experience of a lifetime, probably the best and worst experience of my life. You know, I've been within 18 miles of every location on the British mainland. And I've seen places that, you know, not many people have seen before. Take the Highlands, for instance. You know, running up and down the mountains around there was just absolutely stunning.
And some of the lows?
Injury and weather. You know, I've run through a hurricane in South Wales back in November last year. That was quite an interesting moment. And then suffering with the injury to my back, which almost ended the project on day 284 up in Aberdeen.
Ben's taken on the epic marathon mission to run 401 marathons in as many days to raise money for two anti-bullying charities, a cause which is close to his heart.
I myself was badly bullied for 8 years of my life at school, and like many kids, didn't talk about it, thought I had to kind of deal with it by myself. And unfortunately that grew inside me and affected my confidence and self-esteem. And then at the age of 18, I tried to take my own life. And for me, genuinely, it wasn't a cry for help. I just genuinely didn't want to be here.
After suffering with depression all through his 20s, Ben found himself when he came out as gay at the age of 30. It was at that point he discovered running. Almost 10,000 people have run with Ben, and joining him on his penultimate marathon, a group of intrepid fans and admirers.
Ben is unbelievably inspirational. I'm really excited that his challenge is coming to an end here in Bristol, and that somebody from Bristol is doing something so awesome right here in the city. He's an amazing role model, and I think he's someone for us all to look up to. So yeah, great opportunity to run with him.
It's a wonderful course, and I really want to run alongside Ben, and Bristol's my home city, so very proud to be taking part. He's done very, very well, and obviously he's had a very good team behind him, so yes, he's quite incredible.
It's amazing, isn't it? You know, anyone who goes out for a run, you know, of any distance, you know, the next day they're aching and they're sore, you know, to do a marathon and then go out and do another one. To do that 401 times, you know, it's unbelievable, really.
With a total aim of £250,000 to be raised, Ben still needs £100,000 to make his final target.
Arabic is one of the world's fastest growing languages, and a Belfast academy, the first in Northern Ireland, is leading the way by teaching it to their young students. By adding Arabic to their curriculum, the school are hoping to eye future business opportunities that could benefit the whole of Northern Ireland.
A few years ago, a report from the British Council stated that in the next 15 years, that there are certain languages which would be very important for the economy. And one of those languages was Arabic. So they allowed us to apply for funding for a pilot project. And we were the first school in Northern Ireland to bring Arabic into schooling system as a subject for language and also as a cultural subject as well.
Arabic is just a totally different language altogether with a different alphabet, and like even the the words are spelled like opposite ways, and then the letters aren't like written the same either. It's so far off what English itself is pronounced. Like even other languages that are similar to English are pronounced very similar, but Arabic is just totally different compared to them.
When something is portrayed that has happened because of Islamic extremists, Arabic is often quoted as a slogan, or it's shouted, or it's written on flags. And so therefore, by basic osmosis, Arabic and what is going on in the world seem to be connected, and they're not. They're so different. So what we wanted to do was show children and teach them that language is used by people who have both good and bad intentions, and that Arabic is no reflection on the intentions of the majority, the vast majority of its speakers. And also the hand of friendship stretching out now to Syrians who come and speak Arabic, that people see that our new community of Syrian citizens is an Arabic-speaking community, and it hopefully will help children promote among themselves and others diversity, equality, and build a better society.
Very proud, yes, to see them. I'm very happy with them because they use it and practice. And sometimes when they find me outside, say, Assalamu alaikum, teacher, or Assalamu alaikum. So it's very happy, yes.
That brings us to the end of part one and time for the quiz. Through which British city does the River Ray flow? Is it A, Birmingham? B, Manchester? Or C, Liverpool? We'll give you the answer after the break. Welcome back to Digital Nation. Before the break, we asked you, through which British city does the River Ray flow? And the answer is A, Birmingham. The River Ray is known as the secret river, often flowing underground. Autumn brings a tasty larder to local hedgerows, so long as you know what to pick and what to avoid. And whilst many of us have forgotten about foraging for Mother Nature's free food, STV Glasgow shows us how we can turn these natural freebies into fresh, delicious wines, jams and smoothies.
Scotland's natural larder has many delights to be discovered all year round, but with the season changing, I've come along to Loch Wannoch to learn about autumnal foraging with Hayley Douglas.
So what kind of berries are we looking for then, Hayley?
Well, we've got loads about in this area at the moment. So we've got the favourite, you've got some brambles hidden in the corner here.
Oh yeah, so they're quite ripe, they're ready to pick.
Yeah, and they'll be really tart as well just now, you know, just exactly like you like them. These guys here, the berries, are really good for vitamin C. You can make them into jam, you can make them into wine. So
cool.
There you go, you know, who'd know berries in the countryside. What we can see just growing over the top of the hawthorn though, see these little green berries here? Now these will turn red, these are ones that we have to be really careful of. You can see there's some red ones hidden underneath here, these little like blood droplets.
Yeah.
That is actually a poisonous plant. There's some better ones to look here where you can see some of them are still green.
Don't eat them.
I
suppose that's quite key when you are doing something like foraging, looking for berries. I mean, we're right here in an urban area. There's kids around, it's quite easily accessible. You need to know what berries you're looking for, don't you?
These are round berries, otherwise known as the mountain ash. You wouldn't eat these raw though, they don't taste quite nice. There's a type of acid in them that once it's cooked, that changes and it makes it a lot nicer.
So that's us, we've got quite a good find here.
Yeah, we've got loads. That's exactly what we need for what we're gonna be making next.
Let's make this into a smoothie,
Yeah, let's just do something a bit simple. It's a bit trendy as well, isn't it, smoothies? You know, everyone's out buying them. Easy peasy, just I put in half a banana.
We've washed our berries, we're ready to go.
Milk, ice cream, yogurt, just
whatever you fancy. That looks awesome!
Yeah, look, there
that
we go.
That is so cool.
And that is a wild bramble smoothie. Cheers!
Cheers!
Yeah.
For most people, sex on the beach is a colourful, alcoholic cocktail found in a bar. But for the Institute for Marine Sciences in Portsmouth, it's the study of annelids down by the sea. The team are exploring the reproductive life of the lugworm and are inviting local beachcombers to get passionate about their project.
Castles made of swirly sand tubes are often the only sign of lugworms digging deep under the surface. The coastal worm lives a rather secretive life, and when it comes to love, there's still some things to find out about it.
Spermwatch is a study where we want to find out when the lugworm reproduces. And we actually ask lots of people, members of the public all around the UK to get involved and go out and help us find out signs of lugworm reproduction, signs of lugworm passion, actually.
Lugworms are a key species on the beach. They're a food source for many birds and fish and put nutrients into the sand. But finding the right mate is difficult for the marine worm, which spends its entire life buried deep in the sediment.
It seems to be that they reproduce only in autumn for a few days a year. So that happens in autumn, it's probably around spring tides, we think. And what's really fascinating is that a population on a particular beach, they all seem to be releasing the sperm, so the males release the sperm all at the same time. And this seems to be happening in response to certain environmental cues. So we think it's to do with the moon, so that they actually detect the full moon and the new moon phases. We also think it's to do with weather, so that they're actually sensitive to the good weather conditions.
The research will be going on for 3 years, and scientists are also going to look into the effect climate change has on the worm's reproduction.
Quite a lot of animals start reproducing when a certain temperature is right. And in case of the lugworm, it seems to be when the temperature drops below a certain time, the temperature. So what we think happens is that if climate change might actually cause that this happens a lot later because of the warming seawater and air temperatures. And if this happens a lot later, the reproduction of the lugworm might actually coincide with storm events a lot more, and this could be really problematic for example, for the success of these species to actually reproduce.
The old adage, from gate to plate, is being made real by a city farm in Swansea, where children are given the opportunity to see where the food they eat comes from. The farm promotes interaction with the animals in their natural environment and aims to keep rare and heritage Welsh breeds in the fields and on our tables.
Well, it's a 3.5 acre city farm project. It's actually the only city farm in Wales, so it's really, really special. It basically gives a chance for people who live in the city to get a taste of outdoor life. We try and keep rare and Welsh breeds wherever possible. It's about teaching people where their food actually comes from. The place wouldn't exist if it wasn't for our volunteers that came and did all the work that needs doing. We have pigs, we have sheep, we have our sheep are rare breed Llanwenog sheep, so they're fantastic. We have ducks and geese, we've got chickens, a guinea fowl and some doves. The ducks that we keep are another Welsh rare breed called the Welsh Harlequin, so they're pretty special. You know, we're trying to keep heritage breeds of chicken as well, so that we can help rare breeds do a little bit better. So many city children completely miss out on any aspect of rural life. They don't understand where eggs come from or where meat comes from, or even how, you know, bread grows in fields as wheat and then is turned into it. So we're trying to reconnect people with their food, but also just a bit of being out in the natural environment, smelling those smells, being able to, you know, pat the animals, if they're not pigs, obviously, then, you know, it's all really good for people because you're interacting with, you know, large animals, and it's quite unusual in city life.
Time now for Creative Kingdom and the discovery of science fiction.
So, who is considered the father of science fiction? Isaac Asimov? Jules Verne? H.G. Wells? Actually, it was none of them. The real father lived up north, was doing it as early as the 17th century, and was a mother. Margaret Cavendish, Duchess of Newcastle upon Tyne. Her first job was as a maid of honour to Queen Henrietta Maria, Charles I's wife. But she was bitten by the writing bug and cranked out reams of poetry, prose, plays, and essays in her spare time. In 1666, she published a story called The Blazing World, about a woman who visits the North Pole, is transported to another world where all the animals talk to her, and she organizes an invasion of Earth with fishmen towing submarines and birdmen dropping fiery rocks on her enemies. It's now considered one of the earliest examples of sci-fi. Proof once again that when it comes to creativity, innovation, and going back to the future, in Newcastle Mint.
For young people, experimentation with illegal drugs can have profoundly negative and life-changing consequences. So to raise awareness of the dangers of drug taking, one Birmingham hip-hop artist is using rap music as a way to get the serious message across and appeal to students in their own language.
Kay Kumar, a Birmingham-based musician, rapper and songwriter, has begun touring schools across the UK, promoting the drug awareness message for young students.
Just trying to raise awareness for drugs, you know, with especially with young kids in schools, trying to promote, like, even though they see a lot of things on TV, people taking drugs, and we want to encourage them not to take drugs, because a lot of people think it's cool to take drugs nowadays. Schools have always got people in place to, you know, to talk about drugs in a disciplined way. Like, you know, they'll have a teacher and they'll have sessions, the actual talk, and older people, but obviously we just don't get a bit different, we don't get more entertaining way.
I think a mixture of both is good. I think this way is definitely an engaging way, and also kind of the way he delivers sort of relevant stories about maybe celebrities they know kind of gets their interest quite quickly.
Why do people take drugs? That's the main question. Why take drugs? Anyone? Yeah.
Like I always say to kids, you know, you should talk to your teachers about drugs. And I wish that I had someone taught you when I was young as well, because it would have given me a lot of insight that I now know about now that I didn't know then, which is the reason, like, again, why we're here. Just so younger people that now could have the opportunity to know, be more, you know, aware about things that how they can affect them.
The Queen's House in Greenwich is home to a collection of both historic and contemporary art. Recently restored and now open to the public, the 400-year-old building is a relaxed space that, through public and heritage funding, includes the treasured Armada portrait of Queen Elizabeth I.
It makes absolute sense to see the Queen's House as an art space where you can encounter both historic art and contemporary art, but also somewhere where you can actually feel at home. Well, I think everyone's going to want to come and see the Armada portrait of Elizabeth I. She belongs to everyone. She is a Greenwich girl. She was born in Greenwich. She's on the wall of the Queen's House with all of its history around the women of Greenwich. And I think everyone should come and pay homage to this fantastic portrait that's sitting in the Queen's presence chamber.
Because I helped save it, I raised £662.72.
And this morning when I came into the hall and I looked up and the sun was shining in Greenwich and it was glinting off the gold motifs on the ceiling and it just looked spectacular. And then you think, I am so thrilled to be part of that.
And that's it for this week's roundup of clips from the UK's local TV channels. If you've missed any previous episodes of the show, you can watch them again by going to bbc.co.uk/digitalnation. Or why not check out your own local TV channel's website? So until next time, goodbye.